Thank you for this invitation and for the presentation. I'm very glad to be here in Tirana. Well, there's very good pizza and pasta and everything. It's quite nice to be. Yes, and so my talk is, I noticed from you, it's not a standard hyperbolic systems talk, because I will be using finite elements. And then also I will present this in a kind of different way, using based on the discrete variational principle. So this is non-standard. At the end, what will come out is in principle a quiet standard finite element pick method that was known before, but this is a different way of deriving it that emphasizes some structural properties of the model. And it comes from a variational principle, so we have intrinsic stability and we have an exact conservation rules at the end. So I will, this is the outline, so I will to give a few general reasons why we want to do this structure preservation in our context. And I'm going to use finite elements, but in the sense of finite element exterior calculus. This is what Arnold, Falk, and Winter were introducing, but I try to keep it simple, so I just a few keywords for the people who don't know, and then to present my finite element framework, and then I will present how what I mean by the action principle for the Maxwell equation in the continuous case, and the whole aim of the discretization is to preserve this structure. So derive a discrete version of the Maxwell equations using exactly the same elements that we use for this continuous action process. And then at the end, so some very small numerical results. So first, I have a general slide to present what we are doing in our institutes. Which is magnetic fusion. So the aim here is to confine a plasma long enough in a magnetic cage to achieve fusion conditions. And so the plasma is heated to about 100 million degrees. And in order to keep its plasma state, it should be kept away from any material. So this can be done because it's all charged particles by a magnetic field. And there are actually two devices that are studied to do this, and both are in our institute. There's one here in Garching, which is near Munich. This is where I'm working, in the south of Germany. And there's another one, which this is the tokamak principle. So ITER is based on this principle. And then there's another one, which just started experimenting last week. So the first plasma was last Thursday, so just 1 week ago, and this is the stellarator concept, and this is in the second half of our institute, which is in the north of Germany, northeast, close to the Baltic Sea and to the Polish border, so about as far as possible that you can be from Munich. And so this device is quite interesting. So you see here, this is the standard one, and if you look at the magnetic coils that generate the big magnetic field that we could find in plasma, they are planar, so it's standard coils like this, and completely planar. And the problem of this device is because it's not just a cylinder, you cannot confine it with a pure toroidal magnetic field. So you need to have the magnetic field lines that wind a little bit like you see here on this plasma. To get this, you need a current in the plasma. So in principle, you have a transformer here that generates a current in the plasma. This yields good equilibrium, but for a fairly short time. So you cannot run this in a steady state configuration. So the other idea to get complete steady state is to impose the confining magnetic field completely with coils. Then, as you see on this picture, the coils become a lot more complicated. They need to be really 3D coils. And it's quite a nightmare to build, and this has to be optimized because you have different places. So this is basically axis symmetric, this device like this. So the axis is here and it's symmetric in this direction. And this one, of course, is completely 3D. So it's a nightmare to build, and it has been optimized to prevent losses of particles. And this, in principle, can operate in a steady state. There's no current, so of course local, but no global current in it. And the confining magnetic field completely comes from the coil. But then you see the structure of the plasma, which is this yellow thing, which is not axisymmetric anymore. So this is a real 3D problem. And then we need to also to go to using the numerical methods to simulate this, which is even harder. Okay, and so the problem we get in these devices is that we have a very strong magnetic field that imposes the structure of our plasma, and this brings in a very strong anisotropy, because the particles are confined across the magnetic field lines, but they can flow freely along the magnetic field lines, which means that everything flows very fast along these magnetic field lines, so you have a strong, fast homogenization in the direction of these field lines, and then you get small structures across it. And this, of course, has a big influence on the numeric, so you need to be very careful with this and to devise your numeric so that it's, it fits with this structure where you have long structure along the magnetic field lines and very short, small scale structures across the magnetic field lines. And the other thing is, of course, we want to confine this plasma for a long time. So a long time is in this... so the hope with this new stellarator is that we can get up to about, in the order of minutes, so half an hour or so, confined in human time. And of course, if we want to simulate our fluid models like MHD or kinetic, I don't speak about this for the moment, for such a long time, we need really nice structure preserving methods. So this is why people in this field really like to have variation principles. So when they derive the approximate models for this, so the gyrokinetic model from the Lasso of Maxwell equations, they really want to keep this variational structure and conserved energies and have built-in conserved quantities in the model. So because you go to such a pain to derive your approximate model to conserve all this, it would be not so nice to lose it when you do the numerics. This is why we want to go one step further and not only on the analytic level to have exact built-in conserved quantities, but also at the numerical level. And this is why we're doing this kind of thing. Okay, so what I want to say is that we need to preserve some structure in our PDE. So here you can, the models we're solving are either the MHD equations or kinetically the Lasso of Maxwell or some variants of it. So in this talk I would consider the Lasso of Maxwell equations. Okay, so then this is the aim of structure preserving methods. So when you look at partial differential equations, in general this is just an infinitesimal representation of physics laws. So the conservation laws, which generally you derive by looking at some small volume, and then you go you let the volume size go to zero, then you get your infinitesimal conservation law. And generally you have fluxes, work circulations and things like this, which appear here. But that you can look at on some finite volume. This is the way you see this derived in physics books. And then you stick with the PDE, which is just an infinitesimal representation of these loops. And the idea here of this structure preserving method would be to do this on the grid that we have. So we have this fine structure, which is the grid, and then we want to have this basic physics principle satisfied at the grid level without going to the partial differential equation directly. This is a way to do the discretization. And then there's also some important mathematical properties of our operator that we want to keep in our numerical discretization, so symmetry at junctions typically, and it's also in some cases the kernel of the operators you want. The kernel of the discrete operator somehow to be some approximation of the kernel of your continuous operator, which is important when you have curls or divergences or things like this, where you want the discrete gradients to be exactly the kernel of the discrete curls and things like this. This is one of the important things. Another important point is that we want to distinguish what is topological, so what can be deformed without being changed, from what is metric. And then you keep your numerical approximation error on the metric parts. And what is topological, this doesn't depend on the fineness of your grid, and this you always can get exactly if you do it this way. Okay, and so the general numerical methods that you build, you first do some approximation methods, for example, Taylor expansion, and you try to get consistency. This is generally the way you do the numerical method, and then you try to verify that it's stable. here, well, in this structure preserving method, you get, by the fact that you preserve the structure, you will get automatic stability. Of course, in a linear setting, the only stability you get is A2 stability. You still get oscillation, so it doesn't buy you everything. You get stabilization in some sets where you do non-linear PDEs. But still, it's a nice tool. We first derive the method so that we have this built-in structure, A2 stability, and then we still add stabilization when we get from the non-linear. Okay, so this importance of structure preservation has been seen in other contexts. For example, for ODEs, everybody knows that the preservation of the symplectic structure is very important. This enables you to do very long time simulation of symplectic ODEs and conserve fairly well energy. In many cases also, keeping the structure enables you to get some the right physics at the end without needing to go to very, very fine preservation. And generally, there are in cases like Voigt's spurious eigenmodes in Black Maxwell's equations that could be realized only by using this structure preserving methods. And there's also, in the context of magnetic fusion, the big problem is the anisotropic transport, because, as I said before, the transport occurs very fast along the magnetic field lines and very slowly across. And because the orders of magnitude of difference is 10 to the 8 or things like this, you can't get by pure resolution. So you need really to do this to put this in your numericals. And there's also, of course, very important stability issues that everybody has done MHD knows. You need to have divergence be equal to zero in some sense for stability, and you have the same problem for Maxwell's equations. And for Maxwell's equations, there's the other divergence that is very important, and this you get by using this kind of. And there have been, of course, good. Examples, for example, in the L-shaped domain for Maxwell's equations, you really need to have this structure preserving methods. And there's also a problem with non-simply connected domains where you can have non-vanishing harmonic functions. You can have functions which have discrete zero curl and zero divergence, but which are not zero, and these will pollute your numerical solution if you're not careful about what you're. Okay, so then if you look at the models, what do we have? This is a discussion for our structure preserving numerical methods. We have the different function spaces we look at. So here, typically, if you look at the physical quantities, you have potential circulations, fluxes, and densities. If you look at the functional spaces you are considering, here you have the H1. Function space, here you have H curl, here you have H div, and here you have the L2 space. And then when you construct your finite depth or when you construct your discretization, you want to be curl compliant to this. So gradients of functions that are in H1 will be in H curl, curls of functions in H curl will be in H div, and divergence of functions in H div will be in L2. And then you have this same structure at the discrete level. And then we need, so in some cases you just need this, but if you just travel this way in your complex, this is the topological way, you will be exact. So everything like this, if you do right your derivative, if you work with the right motion, so if basically the standard tensor calculus, you get this, you can do this, everything exactly. But at some point, you will need to travel up again. And then you will need to use basically the dual spaces. And when you use the dual spaces, this is where the metric properties come in. This is why we always need two complexes. So the standard one, where you travel in the right direction and you won't do error by using the approximation, and then the other way up, where you need some approximation. So in the context of finite elements, the second piece, so this the dual piece, this will be approximated in the standard functional analysis way by going to the weak form. And in the finite difference context, you can do this by using the dual piece. So this works for all kinds of of modern magnets. So then again, we have understood this complex. We can try to map this to the language of differential geometry, where you have here we have our four spaces. So this is H1. This will be H0. This is H0. This is L2. And we have the difference in 3D, the different differential forms, so the zero forms. These are scalar functions, and they can be defined by point evaluations. Then you have the one forms, which are vectors, or akin to vectors. These you get by line integrals, the two forms by surface integrals, and the three forms, which are again scalars, by volume integrals. And so I don't want to go too much into details. And then you have the exterior derivative, which will correspond to our differential operators, which on the grid can be represented by this Stokes. You can get an information on the exterior derivative of a differential form by looking at the boundary integral of the form you are considering. And then this gives you the link between the two spaces on the same complex without error, because this is defined directly on the complex. And there you can see that these exterior derivatives, depending on the format to which you are going to apply them, will represent either the gradient vector or the divergence of just zero format. Okay, so then we can look now at our physical quantities in Maxwell's equations. So we have potentials, Faraday's equations, Ampere's law. So the phi, the electrostatic potential, is at zero form. This is a scalar function. Then you have A, the vector potential, and the electric fields are one form. The magnetic induction here is a two form. And these live on the first complex. You can go from phi to B, just traveling, taking exterior derivatives, and this without needing a metric quality. And then you have the same on the second complex. So you have these two. So this is the first, this is the second equation. This lives on the dual complex, this lives on the primary complex. This again dual complex, primary complex. So if you do look at these separately, there's no difference involved. You can get at a discrete level just by doing this integration on the boundary, you can get exact relations between all of these without and this independently of the coarseness of your measure. This works for any measure. Exact. And then you have the link of the fields with the potential like this. This is also exact because they live on the same complexes, and you don't make any error by writing this. So the error, of course, will be made when you will need at some point to relate this D electric field to the E electric field. And this is the constitutive laws of matter, and there you will make this. And this in differential geometry is called the Hodge operator. So this links quantities on the dual complex with quantities on the primary complex. And in differential geometry, you can associate to a P form, an N minus P form, by using this Hodge operator. So this is how we link D and E. So a two form is linked to a one form. You have the link between D and E, and then between B and H. And when you go there to symmetric second order terms, you get this Laplacian, so this Hodge Laplacian, the D star. And then you can look at Poisson's equation. So this is the relation between the D2 and rho. And then you have D2, which is linked to E by this. And this is, here you have Hodge, so you get an error due to the metric approximation. This is exact. And then in the final Poisson equation, you see your Hodge operator. So here you have the metric that actually goes. Okay, so for the discretization, zero forms are naturally discretized as values on your vertices, one forms integrals, so I said this, two forms fluxes, three forms integrals on this. And the discretization of the exterior derivative is exact. So this is a sine incidence matrix. It's a matrix that has only ones, minus ones and zero, depending on if some cell has a relation with the corresponding faces, or a face has a relation, is linked to the edges, or edges to the vertices. And there's no error. And then the error comes here when you link the primary and the dual mesh. And this is the Hodge operator. So you have several ways of doing this depending on the method So this, what I'm telling here is not restricted to finite elements. This works also, so there's a very active area of research in the different in the applied mathematics community. So people use mimetic finite differences. So this has been has originated mostly in the so laser problem, so linked to the other fusion method by laser, so inertia confinement fusion, where they have fluids, they developed fluid codes for doing this, and then they used mimetic finite differences. So this is the work of Shashkov and others. And then Alexandre Ehren more recently introduced what he called the compatible operator discretization. This is also a finite difference that is based on this idea. And then you have the same in the context of finite volume. This is called discrete duality finite volume. So you really discretize differently the primal equation and the dual equation. And for this, in finite differences and finite volumes, you need a dual mesh, and then you need to get some. This is where you approximate this tension. So when you do the association between, for example, an edge of the primal mesh and a face which is it's intersecting of the dual mesh, then you need to do some approximation and to associate some numerical error. In the finite element, this is provided completely naturally by the weak formulation in finite element. And there you don't really need to think. This is or has always been automatic in the finite element. Okay, so I will leave the straight and discrete forms. And now we have this Hilbert complex. So this is what is introduced in this Arnold-Fike and Witter theory, where you have the three spaces, the primal complex, and the dual complex is just obtained by getting back up using the dual formulations. The dual operators of the primal one important thing is that these complexes will be called exact if the image of the operator of this space by this operator is exactly the curl of this the kernel of this operator, this we have here. Im of grad is the kernel of curl, and the image of curl is the kernel of divergence, and these are properties that are very important and that should be preserved at the discrete level. And then we have the curl of grad is zero, the inversion of curl is zero, and we have existence of potentials, and we have the discrete Hodge-Lippmann equation. These are important pieces. Okay, so now when you translate this into the finite element world, you get this finite element calculus. And then the idea is that you get for each of these functional space, you get a discrete subspace. So we were talking about conforming finite elements, which is included in the space, and you get an appropriate projection operator going from the continuous to the discrete space. And you have, at the level of the discrete complex, you still have this exact sequence property. This means that the kernel of the gradient in this space the image of the gradient, in this space would be exactly the kernel of the curl operator in this space. So if you take the gradients of all the B0, the functions in B0, you get exactly the kernel of the curl in the B1 space. And this is the important property. This is also the same for divergence and curl. And for this, you have that when you look at Maxwell's equation, you have the Ampere and Poisson equation, which are dual equations, so there you need. They're defined on the weak complex, but Faraday and DFB equals zero, they define automatically just by introducing the potential. So if you just define E by being this, the gradient of the scalar potential minus D of A dt, and B is the curl of A, you automatically get Faraday's equation, and you automatically get DFB equals zero. This is true because at the discrete level, you still have these relations. This is the on the other hand, Ampere and Bose is more complicated. There you need the weak form, and there you will have an approximation. And in our case, to do the discretization, we're using splines. And we have also the exact complex, which has been mathematically proved by Alain Zapoufa and others. where you can define spline spaces starting from splines of degree p in each direction, which is a conforming subspace of H1. You can define this H12 finite elements, which are splines like this. So you have degree p minus 1 in one of the directions and p in the others. Then you have the H leaf space where you have still p in one of the directions and p minus 1 in the others. And when you take the divergence, you get into this space where you have a spline of degree 1 less in all the directions. So this gives you the nice complex. And when you do this, you can see from Maxwell's equation, because you have this relationship between splines, independently of the degree, so p is the degree of the spline, this works for every degree. The derivative of the basis of one spline of degree p is just a finite difference of the splines of 1 degree less. And this would be very important at the end to get the properties. So here you have the discrete spaces in 2D. And if you plug this formula into your, you define your electric and the magnetic fields with this, and you do this, use the recursion formula for the derivative, you see that the Faraday's law in 2D is just this. So where you have the dB over dt, this is the spline coefficient of B, is expressed with respect to the spline coefficients of E just by a standard, a very simple finite difference formula. And this formula is true for all the spline degrees. So there's no error. For all spline degrees, it's true. So if you do high order approximation, you still have this same approximation. Okay, the error comes in the discretization of the dual complex. And this is Ampere's law. Here we have the mass matrices that come in and the Roger operator. So if you discretize this, you get this formula. And here you have the finite element mass matrix, the curl matrix. So the curl matrix is in principle just the Roger operator, which is a mass matrix in the V2 space, and this incidence matrix, the R12, which is the incidence matrix between the spaces, the edges and the faces. Okay, and then you get this. And here, of course, you have the approximation error, which depends on the order of the splines that you use. Okay, and the divergence constraints will also be automatic. So the divergence being equal to zero is automatic because this is of the primary complex. And the Gauss law is included in the Ampere law also because of the fact that the discrete basis functions here, f, is in H curl, then all the gradients would be in this, and then you can just replace f by the gradient of the function which is in the H1, in the V0 space. And there you get the weak form of Gauss's law, which is included in the Ampere law. So you never need to discretize it. And this is robust on maps meshes, so in finite elements, here you use a reference element and then the mapping. And here we use a global mapping for all the elements together. In this spline method, and because the pullback and the exterior derivative commute, this exact sequence property is preserved independent of the map. Okay, so now I come to my action principle. So the Blasov-Maxwell equation. So now I want to couple Blasov to Maxwell. And there's a nice Lagrangian which has been defined. This is a long time ago. For the Blasov-Maxwell equation. So the important thing is the Lagrangian is based on the characteristics formulation of the Blasov equation. So this means that we don't, what are our functionals here in the Lagrangian are not, there is not f, the distribution function, but it's the characteristics. It's big X and V, the characteristics. And here we always have the f at the initial time. And the Lagrangian is the, we use here the phase space Lagrangian because this is convenient in our context. And this gives us the, by writing the Euler Lagrangian equation of this, we get the equation of motion of the particles. Okay? And so the derivation of the Blasov-Maxwell equations, then just to get them very simply by just writing the functional derivatives, so this is basically the Gateau derivatives of our Lagrangian with respect to all the variables. So if you do this, the variation with respect to the phase space position, you get the equation of motion of the particle, so this is the characteristics of the Blasov equation. If you do the variations with respect to A, the vector potential, then you get this weak form of Ampere's law, and this is just straightforward, you just do the computation. and you get this, and then you recognize the weak form of Ampère. The same for Poisson, and again here Faraday is automatic because of the form of the potentials. Okay, once we've done this in the continuous way, we see that we can get actually exactly the same in a discrete way by just doing a discretization of our characteristics. So when we have the continuous Lazov equation, this is described by the continuum of characteristics. And what we're going to do here to discretize is just replace the continuum of characteristics by some randomly chosen discrete values of the characteristics. This means this is exactly what you're doing in a particle in cell method. So at the beginning, instead of having a particle at the continuum position, which is not possible, you just randomly select some particles according to the initial distribution, and you let just be zero. So this means that here in my Monte Carlo approximation, selecting instead of all the characteristics, so infinitely many, I just select randomly some characteristics. This is a Monte Carlo discretization. And then for the phi and a, for the vector potentials, I just choose the finite element representation of this, which has the same structure. So everything that I did before on the continuum phi and a will be still valid because I am in this context. And when I do the variations at the end, I get the completely standard that was used before, particle cell finite element. So I just do this. So I plug in now my finite element approximation and the particle discretization of the distribution function. I write now my Lagrangian, so the same as before. Now it's completely discrete. It depends on all the particle phase space position and on the finite element coefficients of phi and of a. And here I see this Lagrangian. And then I do the variation of this Lagrangian with respect to the phase space position, the particle positions, and then I get the, just naturally the equation of motion of the particles. And if I do the variations now with respect to the finite element coefficients, I see that I get here, for example, the Poisson equation, I get just one line of the finite element discretization of the Poisson equation. So this is completely natural and embedded in my memory. And if I do the variation with respect to the degrees of freedom for the vector potential, I get here one line of the finite element discretization of Ampère's equation. And the Gauss's law, again, we rely on this discrete continuity equation. And we have divergence B follows from Faraday's equation, so this is still true. And the discrete continuity equation is also included in our variation principle. And here we have this, which represents for one particle, we have this weak continuity equation that tells us that the time derivative of one finite element of the scalar functions will just give us the velocity times this. And this corresponds to our discrete continuity equation, which is also excellent. And so at the end, we get a system like this by doing the variation. So this is the particle motion equations. This is Ampère's equation and Faraday's equation. So as I said, this is just minus ones and zeros in this matrix. So this is a very simple system with no error. And the error is in the mass matrix. And of course can be an arbitrary high order by just choosing a high order finite element space. And what we also get from this variation principle, we could have seen it differently, and of course this energy was known before, we have an exact semi-discrete energy that is conserved. Here we have this Hamiltonian, so this is the kinetic energy, and here you see the electric energy. And so this is exactly conserved, and we derive this from the variation principle, we can guess it also directly from the equation. And we see that our discretization fits into this discrete Poisson structure. This means that if we put everything in our system, U is everything, so X, B, E, and B, so this is the finite element coefficients of E and B, and the discrete particle positions, we see that we have this Poisson structure. So this is the gradient of a Hamiltonian. And this is a Poisson matrix. This matrix looks like this in block form. And it defines a Poisson matrix because it defines a Poisson bracket by this formula. So it's It's now we have an image as a Poisson structure, and then we look in the books where we discretize this Poisson structure, and then you get nice energy conserving method. So there's the famous book for this is the Hiram Bishvana book, where the geometric numerical integration, where you get all the methods for this. And the only difficult thing to verify here is that our matrix is quite, for the matrix to be Poisson, is the Jacobi added. This we do. And now, of course, once we are only semi-discrete, so we have a discretizing time for the moment, so we need to find a time discretization algorithm. If we do not do this right, of course, you can define variable methods which are called Poisson integrators, which can nicely integrate this. But another easy way to do this is to do a splitting, to split between the different Hamiltonians. So this has been proposed recently by Kuzey, Alkema, and Fau for the continuous Maxwell's equation, but it fits completely for our discrete Maxwell's equation. So if we split the equations, we solve successively smaller Poisson systems. So instead of having here the full Hamiltonian, which is the sum of these three, which we solve with one of the three each time. And then we can also have arbitrary high order by just alternating in the right way the different split steps. And here we have fairly simple equations to solve, and the next idea is that all these simple systems, we solve them exactly. These can be solved exactly without numerical error, and then we get exact Poisson integrators. We have exact divergence p equals zero, and we have exact conservation of charge in our equations. So the only difficulty here we have is in the HP, that we need to split again if we don't have very simple formula for the magnitude. Okay, so this is the description of the method. So for the moment, we just did some simple tests to verify that it's working. So we did the Landau damping problem, which gives us damping rate, and we did the bump on tail instability. So we see also that we have the good instability rates. Some other small diagnostic. Of course, this is not for the moment, it's a peak method, so it's noisy. It's not for a 1D problem, I can do it in here. It's not as good as a semi-line branching method. But it has this nice energy conservation property that you won't keep in a semi-line branching method, because there you will project again on phase space and reuse this property. And for our physics colleagues, they like this a lot. So this method, finite element peak, has been used for many years in kinetic simulation of magnetic fusion. It has originated in Lausanne, in Switzerland. And there's a whole family of finite element peak, which is a whole phi family of code, which is based on this method. And so this solves really the five-dimensional gyrokinetic equation and has this exact conservation. And recently also this energy conserving numerical method for glass of Poisson is very old, so it dates back to 1970. But very recently people have looked at this again in the context of gyrokinetic, but for the moment people are doing simpler things. So you have this work and this, where they do the same. And by looking at this further, we can really do some very long time integration more reliably. Okay, so I come to the conclusion, and what I wanted to say here is that for magnetic fusion applications, people like it. Put a big importance in structure preservation, so that the physics is very complicated. So you need to have some things you can rely on. So you have some fundamental invariants in fusion plasma that you want to keep, and that you can get to this structure preserving methods. And as I said, they have built-in stability in A2. Again, I mentioned we still need to stabilize at the end for nonlinear problems, but still they have good properties. And the exact sequence enables exact computation of some differential operators, so we do not do more approximation than what is really needed. So we only project when we need it, and this is when we need a weak form. So the strong forms are computed exactly. And the peak finite element, which is computation gives us a nice structure, and this can be applied also to the gyrokinetic equations, the gyrokinetic equation, which is a little bit more complicated than which I don't talk about. And then there's a theory, you can use the Luther theory for finding invariance from the invariance of the language. Thank you.
Thank you. Questions?
I have several things I didn't understand. But one is that, if I understood, you have a fully, at the end, you have a fully coupled Lasov Maxwell system. So the field acts on the particles through this Lorentz force, basically, and then the particle have an effect on the field. I have not understood if the effect of the particles on the field maintains all these ordinary properties of the original equation, like continuity of the current and things like that.
Yes.
In the case of, so even if it is discretized in terms of particles.
Even if it's discretized in terms of particles, it's you define a particle current, and so the depends what you call the properties, but.
So how does the particle affect the field? This is
part that yes, the particle affects the field. So as you put them in the sources for Maxwell's equation, so you put the particle information goes into the definition of the current, the two chain. This is natural in the way this goes directly to your finite element formulation of the current. And this is how the particles affect the field.
But the functional space has some approximation of the continuous functional space. For example, yes. Rho must be an L2 function, that you said at the beginning, the density, mm-hmm. but the particle rho is like Dirac mass. So
yes, but this one you have weakly, so you don't. Dirac mass is here well put because you consider the weak form here. Yes.
Okay. Other questions?
Do you prefer peak methods or semi-aggregate methods for this kind of application?
Yeah, so this is a hard question, so I cannot. I like this peak method because it has a nice mathematical structure. With the semi-Lagrangian method, in principle, you get nicer results, it's not so noisy, but you cannot prove that you conserve the energy. In peak, I can prove that I conserve energy. So this makes me happy for the peak method, but in practice, it doesn't mean. At least a reasonable short time simulation length semi-Lagrangian method, especially for the results I showed, the semi-Lagrangian is a lot better, even if you can prove and it doesn't conserve energy, the error you get at the end is better. But for very long time simulations, maybe it will have some advantage. So this is, for me, it's more a mathematical game where I find a nice structure. It doesn't mean that I find that peak methods are better. It depends on what you do.
Another question. Can you use instead of Monte Carlo for initial condition, this low discrepancy sequences, smooth loading like quasi Monte Carlo to decrease the fluctuation or the
yes. Oh, no, of course this you can use it of course, but it helps in the linear phase. So if you want to compute lambda dynamic and things like this, then it helps a lot. But if you want to do some nonlinear simulation at the end, then it doesn't help.
Let's say another one. So it's clear that it's by the understanding that the models are constructed in such a way that you have conservation laws for energy, momentum, and also at the discrete level you still have these properties. Mm. But what about applying semi-Lagrangian conservative correction? So that you apply conservative semi-Lagrangian, which I have been proposing.
Yes, but it depends if you apply the semi-Lagrangian scheme on the conservation laws, then it would be different. Here I'm applying it to the Blasov equation, my semi-Lagrangian method. Then I don't get, because when I do the semi-Lagrangian method, I advance my characteristics and then I need to project, even if I'm doing some conservative semi-Lagrangian method, I need to project back on the grid. And there, I could get conservation of mass, of course, this would work, but I wouldn't get conservation of energy. I would lose this on my projection to do it. Because I don't advance an energy conservation equation. So
okay.
course, the mass consolidating the semi-Lagrangian method by the conservation of mass, not conservation of energy.
So you get only the conservation of mass, but not that way.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much again.